everyone. My topic is on current update of adult vaccination, basically. All of you will be aware of the normal sequences of vaccination. This particular slide, I'll be speaking more about the newer epidemic which we all are facing, that is about H1N1. So that is the main update which I want to describe through my slide. My courtesy slides go to Dr. Subramanian, my teacher, who has taught me about the update on current adult vaccination. Why adults have to be vaccinated? Vaccination always we think is only for kids, not for adults. But we need to update our vaccination for the adults based on their medical conditions also. So infection in adults, end of the road for antibiotics. All of us know that we are coming to the end of the antibiotic era, where all the high-end antibiotics or the drugs are becoming more and more resistant. So how are we going to prevent it? The easiest way of solution is the vaccination. Why vaccinate the adults? First, protection from some childhood vaccines can wear off over time, like most common pertussis or diphtheria. Whenever some of the patients travel to US, they always ask to take an acellular vaccine and then visit the child. The reason why, because our immunogenicity wanes off, we can give an infection to the new child. Most of the old parents visit US to take care of the grandchildren. That is the main reason. And they always ask them to take an acellular pertussis vaccine and travel. Viruses and bacteria change over time. The most important one is the influenza. Every year the strain keeps changing. That's the reason why every year new vaccines are manufactured and it is being updated for that year's season. Immune system tend to weaken over time, putting older adults at higher risk for vaccine preventable diseases like influenza and pneumococcal. Adults with certain chronic or immunocompromising conditions are more likely to develop complications like the herpes zoster or the pneumococcal. Adults can infect others. Adults who contract measles, mumps or pertussis can infect their infants who may not yet be fully immunized. That's what we call it as cocooning effect. So that the adults in the family, if they are properly vaccinated, the kids in the family will not be infected. Protect yourself from serious infections like hepatocellular carcinoma or cervical cancer. Even flu vaccine lowers your risk of flu-related infection. Every year, in the beginning of the year or during the middle of the year, like April 2018, this is the vaccination schedule which is updated by the CDC. It is an easily downloadable vaccination schedule which everyone can download it, and every year it's updated. As of 2018, the first four vaccines, the influenza, Tdap or TD, MMR, varicella, these are all the mandatory vaccines for older people more than 50 years of age. It is a recombinant herpes zoster, the varicella vaccine, or the killed zoster vaccine. Previously, it always used to be live zoster vaccine. Now it is a recombinant vaccine or can be a live vaccine. Each vaccine I'll be describing the as we move about. The second one for the adult female and male, the human papilloma virus vaccine, PCV, PPSV 23, based on the medical conditions, hepatitis A, B, meningococcal vaccine, meningococcal B vaccine and HIV vaccine. So we will go through each and every vaccine in detail. These are the recommended immunization schedule based on the medical condition of the patient. Whenever you see any pregnant mother, immunocompromised people, HIV infection who has a CD4 count of less than 200, avoid the live vaccine. The live vaccines are the MMR, varicella zoster vaccine and the zoster vaccine, which we often give for adults in the elderly age group more than 60 years. So these are all the easiest way to remember recommended adult vaccines: the influenza, pneumococcal, Tdap, hepatitis B, hepatitis A, meningococcal, human papilloma virus. The last three are the live vaccines. As per our Indian scenario, the typhoid, ours is an endemic country, you can prefer to give for people. Japanese encephalitis, again, in few regions of our country like Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka or Kerala, few parts of our Tamil Nadu also we do report Japanese encephalitis, Bihar, Odisha and West Bengal. So in those areas, wherever there is endemic, you can prefer to give Japanese encephalitis vaccine. As of now, dengue and malaria vaccines are not yet familiarized or it's not been properly studied for our country. Dengue vaccine has been promoted in US that you can take the vaccine, but as of our country, since we have all the four serotypes, dengue vaccine is not promoted in Indian scenario, so better avoid prescribing your patients for dengue vaccine. This is the newly updated influenza vaccine for the year 2018 and 2019. Influenza vaccine is good for all age group more than 6 months of age. It basically doesn't have any contraindication for administration. This year, they have also included live attenuated vaccine. Every year it used to be inactivated influenza vaccine, recombinant influenza vaccine, and this year it is a live attenuated vaccine also. So you can give among the inactivated vaccine, there will be a trivalent vaccine and a quadrivalent vaccine. Both the vaccines are good and updated. You can write either of those vaccines for the patients. Live attenuated vaccine, the only contraindication is for the immunosuppressed people, even asthmatic patients who may be hypersensitive to the vaccine. So try to avoid those people. No intradermal flu vaccine will be available. Last year there were flu intradermal vaccines, but this year the FDA has not approved intradermal vaccine, so whichever vaccine should be administered intramuscularly. These are the priorities. If you have vaccines, but the right now the influenza vaccine availability is very less. Suddenly it has gone down, none of the companies are supplying. So if you want to choose on priority basis, this is the one. All 6 months wanting to prevent influenza, healthcare workers, we all tend to get infections, so we have to get vaccinated ourselves. High risk people like pregnant women, newborn and children, elderly, medical comorbidities, people with diabetes, household contacts of high risk. For example, a maid who takes care in your family of a bedridden patient, correct? Or an immunosuppressed patient at home. So better you vaccinate that people or vaccinate that maid also to prevent cross infection for the caretaker. Long-term care institution where people are kept in a high acute high care setup or crowded living conditions. You can keep these vaccines if there is availability of vaccine less, you can prioritize. But as such, influenza vaccine can be given to anybody more than 6 months of age. Egg allergy. There is always, we talk about, there is a contraindication for people who have egg allergy. But this time, they have specifically mentioned people who have experienced only hives or little bit reaction after exposure to egg can get any licensed influenza. That means they can take either the inactivated vaccine, quadrivalent, trivalent, or even live attenuated vaccine, appropriate for the age and health. But people who had symptoms other than hives can also get any licensed flu, but the vaccine should be given in a medical setting and be supervised by a healthcare worker. Probably if they had some anaphylactic reaction, that point of time this vaccine cannot be given in an OP setting. It should be given in an area which has a proper healthcare setting. That is the only recommendation mentioned this time. People with egg allergy no longer have to wait 30 minutes after the vaccine. So you need to observe the patient for a period of 30 minutes. Within that, if nothing happens, they will not develop any further reaction. So this is the recommended composition. So you need to recommend this vaccine. Every vaccine, either it's an Influvac or Flu Quadri or Vaxiflu, whichever company name it comes, they should have written it as a 2018-19 strain. It should contain a Michigan, Singapore strain, Colorado strain. Along with Colorado, if it is a quadrivalent, it should contain a Phuket vaccine. So these are the four updated strains for the year 2018 and 2019. The difference between live attenuated vaccine and inactivated is, of course, live, easy to administer. It is just an intranasal inhalational method. You just have to deliver it like a puff, 0.25 ml in one nasal nostril and 0.25 ml in another nostril. As I already mentioned, only contraindication is immunosuppressed people, known asthmatic patients, or immunocompromised people. Even live attenuated this year, you cannot give only for children. The American Association of Pediatrics, they didn't accept the live attenuated vaccine for the kids till the age of 8 years. But after that, live attenuated is accepted. The second important vaccine for the adults is the pneumococcal vaccine. Dr. Anjani already spoke about CKD-related pneumococcal vaccine, why and where it is important. The vaccine preventable death, as mentioned by WHO in the year 2003, it clearly shows that the death rate due to pneumo pneumococcal infections are higher. And WHO recommends a polyvalent polysaccharide vaccine for selected age groups more than 3 years, or people, stable people who are immunocompetent but more than 65 years of age can also take a pneumococcal vaccine. And patients with chronic organ failure, diabetes, nephrotic syndrome, and certain other immunodeficiencies can also take pneumococcal vaccine. So this is the ACIP recommendations for pneumococcal vaccines for the named adults. Anybody between the age group of 19 to 64 years who have all these chronic conditions like diabetes, chronic liver disease, heart disease, or chronic lung disease like COPD patients, asthma patients, alcoholics, smoking, they all can take this vaccine, TPSV 23 is the serotype which is present in the pneumococcal vaccine. This is for 19 to 64 adults with all these chronic conditions. Older adults more than 65 years of age who are immunocompetent, if you want to give vaccine, there are two vaccines available. PCV 13, which has the 13 serotypes, TPSV 23. So these two vaccines should be administered at a interval of more than or equal to 1 year. Preferably always give PCV 13 first and then TPSV 23. The immunogenic response for the older people is good first with PCV 13. Then always advise PPSV 23 and never the other way. Not first PPSV 23 and later PCV 13. Preferably PCV 13 first and PPSV 23 later. The gap between the two vaccines should be more than or equal to 1 year for a better immunogenic response. For adults more than 19 with immunosuppressed conditions like congenital or acquired immunodeficiency like HIV, among patients, chronic renal failure, as you can see for CKD patients, for all the chronic conditions, it is PPSV 23. Whereas for the renal failure patients or nephrotic syndrome, it is PCV 13 first, and then over a period of 8 weeks or more than 8 weeks, PPSV 23. More than 5 years, again repeat a one more dose of PPSV 23. This should be completed over a period of 19 to 64 years. Once the patient crosses 64 years, you can again administer one more dose of PPSV 23 more than 5 years. For adults more than 19 years with cerebrospinal fluid leak or cochlear implant, this often happens in a hospital setup for a RTA patient. For them, the first dose should be PCV 13. After 8 weeks, repeat a dose PPSV 23. So this is the easiest way to remember. 19 to 23, PPSV 23, more than 65 age, adult who are immunocompetent people, first PCV 13 and then after 1 year, PPSV 23. So that is the easiest way to remember. Any immunosuppressed people always begin with PCV 13. Whichever patient comes to you first, always try to prefer to give PCV 13 first and after PPSV 21. A 28-year-old male comes to ER with a clean wound. He has his last immunization at 13 years of age. Does he need a tetanus vaccine? Which one to use? So after the newer guideline by the Indian government, instead of TT, now it is always TB. The reason why? Because the diphtheria immunogenicity wanes over a period of time. So that's the reason why they have combined tetanus with diphtheria. So these are the categories for the clean wound. Or minor wound, clear minor wound, or all other wounds. If it is less than 3 or unknown, yes, you have to give one dose of Tdap. If the child or the adult doesn't remember that they had taken this Tdap at some point of time, to always administer as the first vaccine of Tdap. After 10 years, it should be a repetition of Tdap. That's all. So everybody, they want to get their vaccination with both diphtheria as well as herb cellular pertussis. So along with tetanus, you are giving these two vaccines also. And over a period of 10 years, you keep repeating only with TD vaccine. TD is actually nowadays not available, it's been stopped. It's only TD vaccine. Right now, it is coming only in a multi-dose vial. It doesn't come in a separate ampule, it comes in a multi-dose vial, but maybe after this year, December, you will be getting in a separate ampule of TD also. So, preferred over TD. Has TT, a low dose of diphtheria toxoid, acellular pertussis. For adults, one dose of Tdap followed by TD every 10 years. Contraindication, previous encephalopathy related vaccines in the past. Like most common is with the pertussis vaccine. If they had some past history of seizures or encephalopathy due to pertussis, can avoid this virus. What are the recommendations in adults? Should we vaccinate hepatitis B to all of the adults who ever come to us? So these are the recommendations. Healthcare workers, yes, definitely. Second, chronic liver disease patient, CKD patient, as ma'am already mentioned, patients on dialysis, because there will be dialysis, so they can get cross transmission of hepatitis B infection. 0, 1, 2, and 6, double dose as compared to the normal people. If it is 20 for normal, it should be 40 for the CKD patients. HIV positive, high risk sexual behavior, close contact of family member of a hepatitis B. This often happens in the clinical setup. They will say, my mother-in-law is hepatitis B positive, my father-in-law is hepatitis B positive, what should I do? Stay with them, I cook food for them, what should I do? Should I get vaccinated? Yes, there is an indication that close contact of family members staying with hepatitis B positive people can get vaccinated with hepatitis B. Hepatitis A vaccine, it is not mandatory for all adults, but persons with chronic liver disease, men who have sex with men, people who use illegal drugs, persons infected with other hepatitis virus, persons who receive clotting factor concentrates, persons who have received or are waiting a liver transplant, food handlers. For them, you can choose to give hepatitis A. It is again comes two forms, a live hepatitis A virus and also inactivated hepatitis A vaccine. Inactivated, you need to take 2 doses, 4 weeks apart. Live vaccine, it comes in only 1 dose, 1 shot is enough for entire lifetime. Meningococcal vaccine, whom to vaccinate? Adults with anatomic or functional asthmia or complement component deficiencies, college students, many people who come that my son is going abroad or my son is going to stay in a hostel, probably he is going to stay in a dormitory, you can always suggest their parents to give this meningococcal vaccine. Microbiologists who are routinely exposed to isolates of Neisseria meningitis, people who work in the lab, process the CSF sample, which can have Neisseria meningitis, they also should get vaccinated. Military recruits who stay with each other in close setup, because this particular infection or bacterial infection spreads through the droplet way of transmission, and that is the reason why we isolate. We need to vaccinate people who live in close groups. Person who travel to or live in countries where the disease is hyper-endemic, like the sub-Saharan belt. All travelers to Mecca, that is going to the annual Hajj, during an outbreak given to healthcare workers or lab workers in close contacts of cases. So it is usually given in 3 doses, like 0, 2, 6 doses. And if there is a repeated risk of infection, like the laboratory workers, you can take this vaccine every 5 years once. Cervical cancer. Very young females nowadays keep coming to the vaccine clinic that I want to vaccinate my daughter with the human papilloma virus. Nothing wrong. It has got a very good efficacy of 100% for the female child, and for the male it is around 76% to 80%. Nothing wrong in telling them to go ahead and get vaccinated. A 40-year-old lady and her 11-year-old daughter have come for advice regarding HPV vaccine. The grandmother died of cervical cancer and is hence worried. How to advise them regarding the same? So you can always advise them to go ahead with the human papilloma virus vaccine, which is a bi- and quadrivalent vaccine available, which has to be taken over a period of 3 doses, 0, 1 to 2, in between 1 to 2 months, and then later 3rd dose in 6 months, if the child is less than 15 years of, above 15 years of age. If it is less than 15 years of age, it is 2 doses, 0 dose, in between 1 to 2 months, the second. Both are inactivated human papilloma virus. For girls, the advised age is 11 to 26 years. For boys, usually it is 11 to 16 years or 11 to 18 years. But if men-to-men sex is very common, then till 26 years, even for boys, it can be extended. So efficacy, as I already mentioned, in women it is 100%. For boys also, it is 75 to 90%. In between, there was a flag for medical body. There was in between a controversy which said probably human papilloma virus leads to death in a later state. But after, it was again a contraindication that all those females who died because of this human papilloma virus died because of some other reason and not because of vaccine associated death. So right now, HPV vaccine is safe and it can be administered for the age group which I mentioned, from 11 to 26 years for the female, 11 to 21 for the boy. Even you can select the vaccines based on the HALO checklist, that is health of the patient, that is health condition, age-related factors, lifestyle and occupational or other factors. That's what the each vaccine which I mentioned depends on all these four factors. So you can have this checklist, you can take ticket, and based on that you can recommend vaccination for the patient. A 23-year-old primary gravida comes with a routine second trimester antenatal checkup. Does she need any vaccine? Are vaccines safe in pregnancy? So which vaccine should be prescribed? These are the two important vaccines which we should give. TDAP. Nowadays it is not TT or TD vaccine for pregnant women. In every pregnancy, one dose of TDAP in between 24 to 36 weeks is recommended. Previously it was two doses, now it is only one dose of TDAP, and it should be repeated in every pregnancy. Second important vaccine is the influenza vaccine. Avoid live vaccines for the pregnant female. This is as per the ACIP recommendation, and this is the guidance for healthcare personal vaccination recommendation. So as a healthcare worker, what are we supposed to take? Are the hepatitis B, of course, yes. Influenza vaccine during the epidemic season, take every year shot or an annual shot. MMR vaccine, people who are going to work in an NICU, PICU, where you will get rubella patients or measles patients, you need to get vaccinated. Varicella, yes, you can work in immunosuppressed area or immunocompromised patients, you need to take a varicella zoster vaccine. TDAP, which I already mentioned, it has become recommended now. Meningococcal vaccine, particularly people who work in the microbiology lab. Vaccines for students traveling abroad, meningococcal vaccine, which I already mentioned, TDAP, MMR, varicella, and a flu shot. And depending on the medical conditions or depending the area where they travel, you can add vaccines to this. But this can be suggested to them. Zoster vaccine, the newer change in the zoster vaccine is 50 years or older. The recommended one now is the recombinant zoster vaccine. Two doses should be administered 2 to 6 months apart to adult, regardless of past history of herpes zoster. Even though they had a past history of herpes zoster, or previously they tell I received a live viral vaccine, then also you recommend to take recombinant vaccine, which is an inactivated vaccine with a duration in between first dose and second dose 2 to 6 months. Administer these two doses of RSV 2 to 6 months apart to adults who previously received even a live vaccine. 60 years or older, administer either a recombinant vaccine or a live zoster vaccine. So you can also see our Association of Physicians of India, which has updated adult immunization vaccine. This chapter is written by Dr.V.R.Yamua. So we in Apollo Hospital have a Apollo vaccine and a travel clinic. Along with it, we have a counselor who counsels even for the international travel people or the students who go to abroad. And we have availability of all the vaccines in our hospital. So knowing is not enough, we must apply. Billing is not enough, we must. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions?
Is it necessary to be screening before getting the vaccine?
No, sir. Your screening is not needed.
Thank you, madam. I now invite Dr. M. Susila, join the aircraft in service, hand over the certificate.
function. Now, honoring function.